The Artsakh territory of historical Armenia has been settled by Armenians since ancient times. This fact is evidenced by the numerous confirmed inscriptions and architectural monuments found here. In written sources, Nagorno-Karabakh or Artsakh was mentioned in the records of Sardar II when Urtehe Artsakh region united with the Kingdom of Van. Until the 12th century, Armenians have been the main inhabitants of Artsakh. Let us shift from the most distant pages of history to the 18th century. Documents from 1740s Russian Empire state that the number of Armenians in Nagorno-Karabakh amounted to 100,000 households. In 1798, there were 110,000 Armenian families in Artsakh-Karabakh. At the beginning of the 19th century, during the period of Karabakh Khanate, the head of the general command in Caucasus, Bernevsky, noted that out of 60,000 houses in the prosperous region of Karabakh, barely 5,000 were left. As a result of the attacks, most of the population had moved from the lowlands to inaccessible foothills, mountains and forests. Armenians had re-established settlements, built castles and churches here as well. Shushi was considered to be the center of Artsakh region. It was the citadel of Artsakh with a reputation of a developed and wealthy city.
In the 7th century, Arab tribes have moved into the territory of South Caucasus and entered Artsakh. In their manuscripts, they have described the fortress standing in the current area of Shushi. They have translated its name from Armenian into Arabic. Armenians were calling this fortress Karakarabert, literally Stony Rocky Castle. As we know, Shushi is located on a cliff. We also say that it's a stone head. Basically, Shushi is sitting on a huge stone. We call one of the villages of Shushi, located in the Gorg, Karik-Tak, literally under the stone. The Arabs translated the name of the fortress as Karkarabert. We also call one of the rivers flowing nearby Karakara, Karkar. Probably it should have been called Karkar, deriving from Karkarabert. So from 7th century it has been a well-known Armenian settlement and an unapproachable fortress. Shosh Road, for example, it's a typical Armenian name, my friend.
In the middle of the 19th century, Shushi surpassed Yerevan and Baku in terms of population. Reliable data on the population of Shushi in the whole territory of Nagorno-Karabakh were recorded starting from 1886. According to the tax collection data of Russian Empire, in 1886 a total of 26,806 people lived in Shushi. 15,188, or more than 56% of which were Armenians. The rest were of different nationalities such as Russians or Tatars. At the beginning of the 20th century, in the area where the Nagorno-Karabakh Autonomous Oblast was later formed, Armenians made up 94% of the total population. In 1914, 167,100 people were living within the administrative borders of the former Nagorno-Karabakh Autonomous Oblast. 81% of them were Armenians, and 17.8% were Turkic-speaking ethnic groups or Tatars. The latter were called Azerbaijanis only after the first census conducted during the Soviet era.
There was not even a word like Azerbaijan at that time. Let them find it in history. After all, it is so easy to check these days. There was no such word, no such people. Now look at these photos. These are Armenian families. Thousands of them lived there at the beginning of the last century. My mother is from Shushi. She was born and raised there. Not a single Azeri was there at that moment. I don't know what arguments or evidence they bring and where these arguments came from. My father went to school in Shushi and there were only Armenian schools at that time. They made the modern generation to believe in the false history of Azerbaijan. Even our leader said that 90% of Shushi was theirs. Well, let's talk about Nakhichevan, where Armenians have been the only inhabitants for centuries. And now there are no Armenians, not a single Armenian church is left there. We have seen footage of our heritage being barbarically destroyed, our hajj carts being destroyed, and the world remained silent, witnessing all of that. The same is happening right now in Karabakh. They are constantly fabricating things. There were photographs back then. Let them bring at least one and show us. A fact, a thing, a photo, a piece of paper. At the beginning of the century, 30,000 Armenians were killed in Shushi. When Lenin was told about it, he said it is too late to do anything. There is nothing left. All of this is proven by facts, and I can show these facts.
Azerbaijanis have nothing in common with Albanians. Albanians are Indo-European nation. Anthropologically, they are Aryans, in terms of body constitution. Azerbaijanis are Turkish nomadic people. Anthropologically, they have nothing to do with Albanian tribes.
They say Azerbaijani land, Azerbaijani culture, Azerbaijani something. We have made up terminology. Azer is this, Azer is that, Azerbaijani historic lands. What Azerbaijani historic lands? There is no such a nation up to this day. To satisfy demands of the new Soviet constitution of 1936, some parts of the local Muslim population were automatically renamed to Azerbaijanis. Even today, they don't identify themselves as Azerbaijanis.
Türk deyipler. Allah'a şükürler olsun. 18. ilden 36. ile kadar 18 il müddetinde Türk dili Türkçedir. 36. ilden indiye kadar 60 ildi biz Azerbaycan dili Azerbaycanlı değiliz. Şimdi bas ne diyelim? Bak bunlara bir cevap var yoksa yok. Ah bunlara cevap olmasa biz karar kabul edebilmeyiz.
If in the 1923 the ratio of Armenians to the entire population of the Nagorno-Karabakh Republic was 94.4%, then in 1989 it amounted to 76.9%. In between the censuses of 1926 and 1989, the number of Armenians in Nagorno-Karabakh Republic increased only by 33,800, which has its bitter reasons. Such fluctuations in the population of Nagorno-Karabakh during the Soviet years were conditioned by the anti-Armenian policy of the Azerbaijani authorities. Funding for construction in Nagorno-Karabakh was deliberately reduced and 52 industrial enterprises were closed in 44 settlements. Between just the period from 1940 to 1960, 47 villages in Nagorno-Karabakh were completely desolated. And by 1980, a total of 30% of the Nagorno-Karabakh Autonomous Oblast villages were empty. The local Armenian population also declined because of the Second World War. 35% of the population of Karabakh, or 45,000 people, were drafted to the army then. This was 4 to 5 times more compared to the neighboring regions of Soviet Azerbaijan. 22,000 of Artsakh people perished on the front lines of the war. At the end of the war, on the night of June 14, 1949, thousands of Armenian families were deported from Artsakh to Russia's Altai region by Soviet authorities. Significant changes in the population and ethnic composition have taken place, particularly in the former capital of Nagorno-Karabakh, Shushi. During the 19th century, Shushi became a major center, the fifth largest in South Caucasus. In 1851, 6,357 Armenians were living in Shushi. Meanwhile, in 1920, 47,000 of the city's 60,000 total population were Armenians. The remaining 13,000 were Jews, Russians, Tatars and Turkic-speaking ethnic groups. In the 19th century, the city of Shushi became one of the major Armenian cultural centers, where 23 newspapers and magazines were published by 1920. Only two of those were in Russian. The rest was published in Armenian.
The number of Armenian newspapers printed in Shushi by the beginning of the last century was more than those in Baku and other cities taken together. They killed Armenians later and destroyed whatever was there. You know, Shushi has special meaning for me, other than being the center of Artsakh land. It was one of the Armenian centers as well. There were so many things of Armenian origin there that it is ridiculous to name it Azerbaijanian.
We have had two Armenian theaters there, a printing house, 23 daily newspapers, the Assassin parochial and Realny schools, women gymnasium. Obviously, it was an Armenian city.
Yes, it was an Armenian city in Transcaucasia, or Southern Caucasus, as they name it now. It was one of the major Armenian cultural centers in the region, almost on the same page with Baku and Tiflis.
Translated samples of international literature were printed. Armenian writers in their turn were considering it an honor to publish their books in the printing house of Shushi. The opera Anush by Tigranian was staged in Shushi in 1916. Shushi was considered to be the Transcaucasian Conservatory. As of today, there are numerous local print samples kept in the National Library of Armenia dated back to 1920. This means that neither 100 years ago nor in 2020 did people have a slightest thought that life would turn 180 degrees in a day. How would it be possible for Azeris to live there and not possess at least one print media? By that time, photography was already invented. How many photos can Azeris contrast to hundreds of preserved Armenian ones? None. There is one simple reason behind that. There was no such nation or language at that time. They were Turkic-speaking nomads or Tatars who began destroying the existing culture and its bearers, the Armenians, in order to implement the Turkish plan to form a Turkish Azerbaijan.
Azerbaijan at that time had formed a general governorship there to rule over Karabakh. They had this so-called governor Khosrov Bek Sultanov. During his rule in March 1920, at Novruz Bayram holidays, there was an order to commit a mass killing of Armenians. It was nothing but genocide against the Armenian population of Shushi. There are different estimates from different sources regarding the number of victims, but to me, 30,000 Armenians were eliminated.
1920, Colonel Thompson forced the independent government of Armenia to call Andranik back from the village of Akhavno. He was coming to rescue Karabakh. Within 3 days after the withdrawal of Andranik, Turkish army invaded and killed 30,000 Armenians in Shushi. They had literally slaughtered the people, including the leader. He was butchered. They were cutting his neck slowly with the blunt side of a knife. After they destroyed the city in 1920, Shushi became a closed settlement for a long time. They wouldn't let people in, as there were obvious signs of their barbarities, all the way up to 1971-72. The city was in ruins. We have the photos. Skors Davtyan and Shahin Makachan had published a book named Shushi, The City of Tragic Fate, with numerous photos included in it.
In total, the fortress city of Shushi was burned by the enemy 3 times in the 20th century. In 1905, in 1920, and in 1992. Many chroniclers have witnessed the 1920 massacre of Armenians in Shushi. In 1936, Russian poet Mandelstam shared what he saw during his visit to Shushi. His wife writes,
"The once prosperous Armenian city was reduced to rubble. The wells were filled with the bodies of women and children. The houses were empty, without roofs. There was not a single breath in the city."
After visiting Shushi, in the late 1920, famous Soviet writer Marietta Shahinyan wrote,
"I was astonished by the silence. I've never felt such terrible artificial silence. Suddenly, it seemed to me that the silence was muttering. The stones were whispering, moving and shuddering, and the hair stood on end. In March 1920, 7,000 houses were destroyed and burned here within 3 days. According to various sources, over 12,000 Armenians were slaughtered. The fact was, none of the 35,000 Armenians living in Shushi were there anymore. Women's hair mixed with dark blood could be seen somewhere in the nearby streams. It was tough for a person with imagination to read. You keep walking along the rows of buildings burned down to ashes, rushing in fear that you may never leave this place.
During a meeting in Kremlin in the same year, Soviet state and party official Sergei Orjonikidze said that he can't help but feeling horror, recalling what he had seen in Shushi in 1920.
The once Armenian city of Shushi was fundamentally and completely destroyed. The corpses of Armenians were everywhere. The wells were covered with blood and dead bodies.
Orjonikidze was telling this to former Musafat Azeris, who had already taken the Soviet flag, hoping that they will realize their past mistakes and change their inhuman nature. Nevertheless, the history tends to repeat itself, and it repeated in 1988 in Baku, Sumgait, then in all other Armenian populated cities of Azerbaijan. The first and only president of the USSR, Gorbachev, spoke openly about it.
Yes, the former authorities have messed up the situation in Nagorno-Karabakh. They have offended Armenians. The region is underdeveloped and degraded. They have cut all ties with Armenia. Now, by the decree of Communist Party Central Committee and Minister Boards, we have granted 500,000 rubles for 113,000 Armenians living in Nagorno-Karabakh. We need to build everything, schools, libraries, roads, hospitals, whatever is needed. The military commandants are reporting directly to me. Everyone is involved in this endeavor. Secretaries of oblast committees, chairmen of executive committees, leaders of regional structures. Well, this lawlessness. Armenians are being eliminated in front of police and nobody cares or does anything. Bandits are stopping people on the border and robbing valuables, seizing earrings straight out of ears, snatching the ear itself. These outlaws have turned into brutals. 214,000 Armenians are living in Baku. Think how terrified they are. They are protected with armies for the same not to go burst out there. Nevertheless, it had already started, but how far can it go? So, the Karabakh. We will solve the social economic problems, language, and cultural barriers. Afterwards, we will see what else can be done to calm down this tense situation.
The question of Artsakh existence was put on the table, and despite countless pressures, Armenians managed to rescue the people of Artsakh and most of its territory. Shushi, along with surrounding villages, was regained.
The city was destroyed when we entered Shushi. Then we found out that during the Soviet years, Azeris have pulled a road over Armenian graves there. That could only happen with the permission of Aliyev's father.
Shushi was revived once again, and Armenians came together to rebuild the ruined city. Armenians, by the way, did not demolish any significant buildings preserved in the city from the Soviet times. When Armenians entered Shushi for the first time after a liberation in 1992, both churches and mosques could be found in the city. They were identically preserved, moreover, many of them were renovated in following years.
Morning of May 9, 1992, all of us were rushing towards Amenaperkich, All Savior Church. It was the ending point of every single squad. If we made it to the church, Shushi would be ours. What we saw first was a church All Savior. It served as a large military ammunition facility. We made a prayer, a Christian ceremony, praised the Lord, then took out the ammunition.
I was tired as I haven't slept for the whole night, barely had a nap in 3 days when Zori Balayan called and told me to hurry up towards the church to see what was going on there. I went there and the first thing I saw was our church. Inside of it was what would be shown later a lot, the Grad missiles for example, shells, bullets. It was transformed into a military storage. Not a single mosque was crushed, even some of the mosques were reconstructed. Our neighboring country of Iran had signed a contract to come and help with renovations. All of the churches and mosques were dysfunctional. The domes and rooftops were broken. It was messy inside. The walls were vandalized. Crosses were missing. So first of all, Archbishop Parkev took the responsibility of renovating the church in the shortest time so that we could conduct our religious ceremonies and prayers.
There was one Russian church in the central square where Vazgin Sarkisian statue is located now. It was called Russian Greek Orthodox St. George Church. They have ruined it. Only two Armenian churches were left, the Amenaperkich and the Green Church, known as Karabakhtsots, or St. John the Baptist, Surpovanes Mokotchits. It was built by the governors of Jalalyan dynasty, along with ordinary people. There had been a magnificent temple made a sanctuary nearby. Down the road from Amenaperkich Church, there was the Megretsots Monastery, which was blown up. A little further up, there was the Aguletsots Monastery. Not far from the Green Church was Astvatsatsin Church. In general, it is all well-known fact that there had been seven big Armenian churches and five more small ones in Shushi.
In mid-2020, the Azerbaijani propaganda starting sharing photos set particularly for the European audience. The photos included the round part of the dome of one of the Armenian churches. Azerbaijan deceitfully exploited this fact to state that the shape does not resemble a dome of an Armenian monastery, therefore the church is not Armenian after all. To make this clear, let us state that only one of domes has that shape and there is a reason behind it.
The Church of St. John the Baptist, also known as Karabakhtsots or Green Church, had a round-shaped dome. I can tell why. The ledges under the dome were made quite narrow by mistake. If the builders were to put a steeple on top of it, the holding neck would be too thin and the edges would be too far from each other. It would be something like a mushroom. My brother Ashot was an engineer. I asked him to think of a way of putting a steeple on it. He asked for 1 week to figure out. He went up and down the structure, eventually managing to tailor a more or less appropriate steeple on the top of it. Probably, in ancient times, they couldn't figure out a way to do it with such narrow ledges. It was constructor's mistake. Ridiculous things are being told about bringing Udis to Dadivank. First of all, never have ever Udi people lived in the territory of Artsakh. Take the data from the Soviet encyclopedia. Before the collapse of the Soviet Union, there have been 6,000 Udis in total. They were living in Azerbaijan and in Georgia, a small nation with only 6,000 representatives. A small part of them have converted into Islam. Those living in Georgia were professing Orthodox Christianity. Interestingly enough, most of the Udis were Armenianized. They even took Armenian first as last names. This is a well-known and proven fact. You can find it in any encyclopedia. Today, they try to present Dadivank as Avang heritage. First of all, Dadivank is located on the historical territory of Artsakh. It was built by the Armenian authorities. That is a well-known fact. The first monastery was founded in the 4th century by St. Gregory the Illuminator, the Dado Monastery. Then the governor Vakhtang, father of Hasan Jalal, met his son to build Ganzasar, a superb, unparalleled church, to replace the old humble one. Armenian manuscripts could be found everywhere. They have nothing to do with Arvant heritage. In fact, the Arvant Regency was established by Persians. When the Armenian kingdom collapsed in 428, Persians appointed Eastern Armenian Vachagan's kingdom in Artsakh. The Patriarchate was kept intact, Armenian state, Armenian Patriarchate. It would include historic Artsakh, Utik and the left shore of Kur River. The territory was called Caucasian Arvank. We have the list of all Arvank patriarchs. All of them were Armenians. Whose heritage? It's an Armenian heritage. Moreover, the territory of the Arvank Patriarchate established by St. Gregory the Illuminator and ruled by his grandson was stretching all the way from northern Caucasus to Astrakhan. Those areas have been Christian until Arab invasion. Both Chechens and Ingush have once been Christians. There are even cities there with the names like Khachmaz. Khach is Armenian for cross. But after Arabs came, in between 7-9 centuries, they had Islamized those people.
You would remember the Dadivan case when they brought those people, Udis, in there. They talk a lot about that. They'll bring them to some other places as well, to Amaras, let's say. Some people will tell you that Azerbaijan had appointed an Udi Ahvanian priest there in Dadivan. First of all, that person is not a priest. Secondly, Ilham Aliyev is not the Catholicos of Ahvan to have the authority to appoint a Christian clergyman anywhere. So we should not give in to those Azeri tricks.
All of this was clarified in the Soviet-published book Cultural Monuments of Nagorno-Karabakh by Shahen Makarchan, which can be seen in the fund of the National Library of Armenia. According to the book, 9 of the churches built in Karabakh during that period had dome structure. 5 of them were located in the city of Shushi. Those are the monasteries of Razanchetsots, Agulecots, Megretsots, Ganadzham and Kusanats.
It is an Armenian church with inscription on it. Typical Armenian church. People name it Karabakhtsots because it was a Karabakhtsots neighborhood. There was a Agulecot church in Agulecot neighborhood. Razanchetsots church in Razanchi people. Megretsots was founded by people from Megri. Back at that time, people had migrated there from different areas, and the churches were named after their homelands. Anyways, each church has its official ecclesiastical name as well.
It should be noted, however, that our churches have been in poor condition where they came under our control in 1992. They were destroyed and dilapidated. Shushi, which once had 2 mosques and 12 churches, came back to us in rubbles. In 2020, the city was given away, flourishing and restored. No matter how Hartson would try to describe it as a bleak and miserable. Azerbaijani claims about possession of 17 mosques are baseless and nothing more than a fairy tale. Even when Shushi was being part of Soviet Azerbaijan, there were only 2 abandoned mosques.
No mosque has been there, no photos to prove that claim. We have photos from all around the Shushi, from the end of the 800s, in 900s, there have been only 2 mosques. We even completely renovated one of them. There were 2 mosques in Shushi. One of them was a Persian mosque, and I have ordered not to damage them. Even when we were liberating Agdam, I asked our guys not to shoot toward the mosque. And nobody made a single shot. So, only 2 mosques have been built in Shushi within 200 years.
A huge number of our churches were left unattended on the territory of modern Azerbaijan. Hardly anyone could tell the exact number of them. They were defiled, cowsheds were made inside. In the meantime, we were renovating their mosques that everyone was able to witness one more time recently when Azeris entered Shushi and prayed namaz in those mosques. Thanks for not praying namaz in the Saint Razanchetsots.
Let's move on and talk about the new challenges. Today, when the internet by all means is a significant part of our life, it's easy to notice a special policy of state directives from the Azerbaijani side. In the last 2 years, more than 100 films and stories about the city of Shushi in English, Russian or Azerbaijani have been uploaded by Azeris. On the other hand, from 1994 to 2018, hardly 5 videos about Shushi made by Azerbaijanis could be found. What is the reason behind this sharp activation? We can only assume that the Azerbaijan was aware of the upcoming surrender of Shushi. There is a shortage of similar Armenian movies or programs on YouTube in recent years. One can hardly find just a few videos or films. The most valuable among them is a 52-minute film about Shushi by Zori Balayan, uploaded about 4 years ago. The audience of this film is surprisingly low though, just about 200 views. This would mean that there is no state concern to distribute or promote such films. Another noteworthy observation. Any Armenian language film uploaded to the internet has less viewership than those on the opposite side. This means that our country needs to put serious efforts on the informational front lines as well. To give the viewers a perspective of what we have really lost by surrendering Shushi, let's reveal the data brought up in response to our inquiry to the Cadastre and State Property Management Committee of Artsakh Republic. According to them, the area of Shushi community before the 44-day war covered more than 6,549 hectares, 780 hectares of which were residential. There were 3,073 properties registered in the community, 738 of which were residential houses and 1,262 were apartment units. There were 580 units of industrial and social facilities, 493 units of land plots. As a result of the war, more than 4,104 hectares of the land were left out of Artsakh's control. 586.5 of it is residential land. Today, there are only 27 buildings under the control of Artsakh, 14 of which are residential and 13 are of social or industrial significance. In plain words, in terms of territorial data, we can say that we are left with crumbs of the Shushi community. The lost territories and units, of course, are incomparable with the price paid by the Armenian people through the blood of their children. Shushi is certainly the most significant of the lost territories, as the fall of Shushi broke the spirit of the fighting army, volunteer forces and civilians. This is the exact opposite of what happened when we liberated Shushi. Today, however, the Armenian origin of the city is being questioned at the state level. This did not happen even in Soviet times. On the 599 to 601st pages of the Volume 8 of the Soviet Encyclopedia of Armenia, where strict rules of Soviet censorship were applied, there is no claim that the city of Shushi is Azerbaijani. According to the Soviet census of 1979, 1,409 Armenians lived in Shushi. This is actually the latest accurate census data for the city of Shushi, as the 1989 census has not reported anything about the city of Shushi at all. The statistical findings based on the latest data from the Soviet census provide information only on the total number of people. According to the census organized in those very uncertain times, there were probably no Armenians in Shushi. But even at that time, nobody would say anything about Shushi being Azerbaijani, as no one questioned the Armenian roots of the city. The ancient churches were built long before the formation of Azerbaijan. As for the mosques preserved after the Armenian liberation of the city, the history attributes them to many nations but not to the Azerbaijanis. While studying the archive materials related to Shushi, we recorded a remarkable fact. All the numbers available in the printed databases or on the internet referring to the 1989 Shushi census lead to a single source, an Azerbaijani named Elchin Amirbeyev. This is an article posted on the internet on 2001, when he was a listener at Harvard Kennedy School of Management. The article is speaking about the Shushi region of 1989 being inhabited 90% by Azerbaijanis. This does not refer only to the city of Shushi, but the surrounding areas as well. The letter covered more than 10 villages at the time. Same Amirbeyev stated that Azeris made up about 100% of Shushi's population during those times.
Ilham Aliyev is a fan of Dr. Goebbels' statement. The lie repeated 100 times becomes a truth, especially when there are no countermeasures taken.
The search algorithm of internet giants such as Wikipedia or Google, linking the authenticity of data about Shushi in 1989 to the same source, the above-mentioned student article published in 2001. One can only conclude where the roots of the lie about 90% of Shushi being inhabited by Azerbaijanis come from. Elchin Amirbeyev later took over diplomatic positions in European countries, including Vatican, probably in order to promote the Azerbaijani propaganda. All those figures that you see have been confirmed by the State Economic Archive of the Russian Federation. There is no word about 90% of Shushi city or Shushi region. In our view, the statement by the Prime Minister of Armenia may be based either on the above-mentioned student article or similar information contained in some confidential documents. The latter may have served as a source for Amirbayev, the current aide to the President of Azerbaijan, in preparing his student article on November 30, 2001.
There hasn't been any discussion during the whole negotiation process that the Azeri refugees would not return to Shushi. Moreover, before the conflict and the liberation, Shushi had consisted of Azerbaijani population in 90% or more. So you want to say that the city of Shushi, with over 90% of Azerbaijani population, can be considered Armenian with that status?
Maybe masses is not Armenian either. Let's concede masses as well. If you agree, Aliyev will generously pay for Yerevan as well, for sure. We should understand that it's impossible to separate history and politics. They are tangled. Administrative unit cannot serve as a proof of this or that territory's historical affiliation to any nation or a country which did not exist at all. Azerbaijan is a project. The official Azerbaijani propaganda speaks about Yerevan being founded by Revan Ghuli Khan. According to them, it is a native Azeri city with the majority of Azerbaijanis. So, if we follow these opinions without providing counter-arguments, then some would think, why do we need this bleak and miserable city of Yerevan? I am not going to specify names, but some people doubt this, attaching no importance to the historical affiliation of Shushi or Karabakh in general. For Azerbaijan, however, it is of utmost importance. They throw their propaganda and manipulate with facts.
Kars is an Armenian city, isn't it? Erzurum is a historical Armenian city. Is it right? Yes. Today it is inhabited by Turks or Kurds, maybe more than 99%. But it doesn't mean that they are not historical Armenian cities. It is a natural and obvious thing. Population can fluctuate, but is not an indicator of affiliation. Now, we can recall Yerevan of 1918. If you know, around 50% of the world population was not Armenian. They were Persians, Tatars. Only 14,000 out of 28,000 were Armenians. Mean, however, that Yerevan is not an Armenian city.
This was followed by various explanations from some members of the parliament. Some stated that there is no doubt about Shushi being Armenian, while others made an in-depth attempt to substantiate what Pashinyan actually meant.
90% of the population of Shushi as of 1987 were Azerbaijanis. Therefore, in case of the alleged return of the refugees, the population of Shushi would have become 90% Azerbaijani again. Had the Prime Minister agreed with the return of refugees without fixing mechanisms to determine status of Artsakh, Shushi would have effectively drifted under Azerbaijani control.
Even the President of Russian Federation was stunned by the views of official Yerevan on the possible status and destiny of Shushi, the historic capital of Artsakh. He spoke about that in one of his recent interviews.
In general, I've managed to persuade President Aliyev to cease fire, but he had one compulsory precondition, and that was the return of all the refugees, including to the city of Shushi. Nevertheless, it was unexpected for me that the position of our Armenian partners was formed in a way that was unacceptable for them at that moment. The Prime Minister Pashinyan told me of that precondition being dangerous to the national interests of Armenia and Karabakh. Up to this moment, I cannot clearly understand his concerns regarding danger of threat. I mean, the return of peaceful population was planned with the Armenian side retaining control over those territories, including Shushi, accompanied with the participation of our peacekeeping mission, which was agreed at that time.
As for the 90% in the speech of Prime Minister Nikol Pashinyan referring to the fact that before the liberation of Shushi, the city was supposedly populated by Azeris, the idea to search the internet for open sources or to do a research of historical materials was given to us by the Republic Armenian Prime Minister's Administration. The Prime Minister's Press Office, or the Department of Information and Public Relations to be exact, have sent us a letter in response to our inquiry. According to the letter, there is no secret archive or secret folder. Pashinyan has used the open sources on internet, quoting probably the most accessible information he could find about Shushi. And that was an obviously false information from the Aliyev side Amirbeyev. The same sources on internet are popular for publishing ridiculous and absurd information. If we refer to that source according to which there was a census and the Azeris made up 90% of the population, then we will have to go further and refer to the census of 1999, which states that Azeris held around 95% of local population. You were right if you heard the year 1999. But you are free not to believe it. The same source says that according to the census of 2009, 120,000 Armenians were living in Azerbaijan. It also states that the Khanate of Erivan, part of the Russian Empire in 1886, later became part of the Azerbaijani SSR. All those ideas derive from the same source, the one with 1989 Shushi census data. Why do we have to believe it in one case and question it in another? In 1989, Armenians was already deported from Shushi and the city was used by Soviet Azerbaijan to bomb Armenian settlements and keep them under fire. The city was militarized during the war, hence there couldn't be a word about peaceful Azerbaijani population and census. Various sources claim that even most of the Azerbaijanis living in Shushi had left that year and the city was controlled by the military officials. When Armenians liberated the city in 1992, it was already empty and abandoned, except for a few houses on the outskirts of the city inhabited by elderly people. The videos made at that time show that the city was not destroyed or abandoned in a few days or even a month, as restarting living Shushi long before the liberation. How did they count the population in such a situation and determine the percentage of Armenians and Azeris living there? The fact that there were more than 90% Azerbaijanis in Shushi in 1989, or the census conducted in Shushi in January 1989 in general, is a hoax spread by the Azerbaijani authorities with the aim of claiming Shushi as an Azerbaijani city in the future. What happened to Shushi comes to prove that this intention had a long-term goal and a clear plan, which unfortunately was implemented. The reality is that most of the society members are not in the habit of checking and contrasting facts. Later they become target audience for such ideas told from high tribunes. The fact is that the return of refugees does not mean the expulsion of those living in the area at the same time. Therefore, even if Shushi was populated by Azeris by 90% about 30 years ago, and even if the same number of them returned, the city of Shushi would never be resettled by Azeris in the same proportion. Citing Azeri sources, let us assume that about 15,000 of the alleged 17,000 returning residents were Azeris and the other 2,000 Armenians. Then, even if it's added to the number of 5,000 Armenians living in Shushi in 2020, the ratio would be 15,000 versus 7,000, or percent-wise, 68% versus 32%. Remember that those are just alleged and unrealistic calculations. First of all, how many of those alleged 90% would return? Or how many of them would be identified, documented, and persuaded to come and live in the Armenian-governed city of Shushi, side by side with Armenians? Few would agree to return with about 5,000 Armenians living there. So in the event of refugees, return getting real, Armenians would prevail in Shushi multiple times. To give a plain example, imagine all the Armenian refugees being allowed to return to Sumgay tomorrow. How many will go or how many are still alive? Therefore, the government's assertion that accepting the prerequisite of the refugees' return would not have solved the issue of Shushi is a primitive trick. The circumstances of Shushi's surrender have been questioned not only at the public level, but also based on the eyewitness testimonies and conclusions from military experts. Those facts form a completely different picture.
We have lost Shushi, but how we lost it? Nobody wants to answer that question now. The city was simply surrendered. My assistant, Samvel Khachatryan, is a retired colonel. Upon his return from Karabakh, his brother-in-law told us about finding Shushi empty on the 4th or 5th of November. He had gone there to transfer 54 prisoners from local jail to Yerevan. He had met just a few military policemen from Yerevan there. The city belonged to nobody at that point. No army, no civilians, no Azerbaijanis have been there. Nobody wants to talk about that. I found out that the battles towards Shushi were conducted in two completely contradicting directions. There had been a chaotic situation around there. It certainly provides food for thought. Had the Azerbaijanis conquered the city themselves, they would have surely shown serious excitement. As far as it was given easily to them, they just showed an entrance of an armored car through the gates of the city by just a few members of special forces, and that was it. I'm being frankly asked how we liberated Shushi back at the times. Well, our troops were equal to them, though we needed to exceed them in number to succeed in such unfavorable mountainous conditions. Vasyan Sarkisyan asked me if we could manage to attack and succeed. I said yes, of course, even though I was realizing the lack of resources. But I was a commander, and if there was an order to attack Shushi, then I had to do that. Then I have been told that there is no need to attack as the political leaders are trying to solve the issue on diplomatic front. Our president was meeting with Demirel and Yeltsin at that moment, so we shouldn't interfere. I explained the situation to other commanders, adding that we had to wait for around a month. They responded, however, that nothing would be left from Stepanakert after a month. We had machine guns, but they owned Grad missiles falling like hail on Stepanakert from Akhdam. They were strengthening their positions day by day. I am a happy commander because my soldier was motivating me to go to the fight and to liberate Shushi by all means. And we have done that. It was an unprecedented case in the history. We managed to enter the city with strength and agility. The thing is, we have praised ourselves a little too much. New war, new territories. We were aware of their military budget exceeding our entire state budget. But we were unrealistic. They were arming with the latest technologies and weaponry, and we seem to be missing that. Basically, we have shortcomings that needed to be addressed. Moreover, Azerbaijan was not fighting against us all by himself. Turkey was standing behind them with its entire arsenal. Even during the years of the first Artsakh war, they were helping Azerbaijan, regardless of the fact that they were part of the Soviet Union. Seven states were fighting against Armenia. They even say there was treason from within Armenia. Time determines the type of war. The next one is going to be a war of minds. Thanks God, Armenians are strong in it. Our mindset and the unity of our nation can bring forward tremendous changes. I'm sure that the lost areas of Artsakh, including Shushi, will be liberated again.
Whoever controls Shushi will gain control over Artsakh as well. You know that Shushi stands on the overhead of Stepanakert, where people are scared to go out to the streets. Otherwise, they might be shot by somebody from Shushi.
Shushi is Armenian, regardless of anything. And one day it will be ours again. And that day is not far away.
Karabakh bizimdir, Shusha bizimdir, Bakı bizimdir ve Azerbaijan Ermenistan'dır.
That was what I was telling them in response to their waving hands. Not everything is forsaken. Those in Azerbaijan who think that the current humiliating situation is acceptable for everyone here except the former ones are terribly mistaken. The so-called revenge, factually the triumph of justice, will rise not from the former ones, but from our people, who have never lost and will never lose. Too soon for Azerbaijan to perform a triumphant Muğam in Shushi.
It was always been Armenian and it will remain Armenian.
It should not only be a cherished dream for every patriot of his nation, but also a state program. An open and transparent plan if you want, but you must prepare for it every day. Strong and smart people need to be unified. After all, historical fate has not always been kind to Armenians. At different times, the nation has been exiled for some years or even entire centuries, losing this or that part of the homeland. Parts of Artsakh have been under Persian and Russian rules, but those nations do not question the Armenian origin of the territories. After all, there are no Armenians in Nakhichevan now, not even crosstones, Khachkars, are left. When the time comes, should we rely on the Soviet census data again? What time frame should be followed in such cases? 200 years, 100, 50, or maybe just the last 10 years? Maybe we should be guided by the international agreements and documents. If that's the case, where is the Azerbaijani passport of Shushi? How can it exist at all, when the birthplace of the city is Armenia?
While the Armenian descent of Shushi was being questioned at the highest level in Armenia, the barbarians completely destroyed the Green Church of Shushi and removed the dome of Hasan Chetzot's church by the order of Azerbaijani authorities. The perpetrator managed to do that before the premiere of the English and Russian versions of the Armenian second TV channel's documentary movie Shushi, the preparation of which took less than a month. As 100 years ago, today's heroes of vandalism also started the program of eliminating Armenian traces in Shushi. Our movie is a peculiar tribute to the memory of the Armenians who have heroically fallen for the city of Shushi. Indeed, Shushi is Armenian, and it will definitely be ours.